Thank you, Leslie, very much. I know I speak for all of my colleagues here at the table in saying that we are very grateful to have the honor of addressing this group. And I know I can also speak for them when I say that we have certainly been convinced by our predecessors this morning of the civic obligation to put our support behind the modern military. However, not to the point ever again of allowing ourselves to follow them in a panel discussion, but we will do our best. And let me get the ball rolling by saying that I will take it, and I think I may safely take it as a given, that we are living in a society which is increasingly characterized by a kind of rhetorical and, to a degree, substantially intransigent approach to civic life. Polarization is the one word which seems most frequently to characterize the public, or at least the articulate public life around us. And to constitutional lawyers, there is something very disquieting about that, because there is a distinct dissonance between a rhetoric and a substance of polarization, and both the history and the required practice under the Constitution of the United States. And let me just take a second to elaborate both on the history and the practice to explain why it is that constitutional lawyers as a particular group find the current state of discourse disquieting. As for history, those who have studied the history of the 1787 Constitutional Convention invariably start correctly by pointing out that in the mind of James Madison, the most significant issue that had to be resolved anterior to all of the other substantial decisions to be made at that convention was the issue of representation in Congress. Was it going to be on a state-by-state basis, or was it going to be on a population basis? And as a subset of that concern, how was representation going to take into consideration the difference in interest between the slave states and the free states to the north? We know how those issues were resolved, and they were resolved by what is frequently called a great compromise. And we know what that resolution was. The states are equally represented in the Senate. The population is the basis for representation in the House. And for the period of time between the ratification of the Constitution and that of the 14th Amendment, the provision in the Constitution for recognition of the institution of slavery on the matter of representation was the so-called Three-Fifths Clause, which, as I said, did not survive the 14th Amendment. But the point that constitutional lawyers and scholars and historians of the Constitution can never forget is, I think, as it was put in Jack Rakoff's book, Original Meanings, a few years ago, that the resolution of these representation issues by compromise was the necessary, not the sufficient, but the necessary condition for the resolution of the substantial issues and the capacity of the convention to propose a constitution which ultimately succeeded in being adopted. So that the American polity is in fact governed by an instrument whose most signal feature of history is the compromise that made it possible. What I meant when I said a second ago by the compromising nature of constitutional practice is something like this. I think we are all intuitively aware of the fact that as between the powers granted to the national government, or for that matter reserved to the states, that can be found or inferred from the structural part of the Constitution, there is frequently a clash, and intended to be a clash, with the structure of rights guaranteed to individuals by the Bill of Rights, including the 14th Amendment. These clashes are not resolved by any text in the Constitution itself. They cannot be resolved by regarding either the powers of the government or the civil rights of the individuals as absolutes. They can only be resolved by regarding them as competing principles, each good in itself, but none of which can be exercised to the limit all the time. There is a constant process of adjustment. There is a constant drawing of line and sometimes a shifting line over time and over changes of circumstance. And the Constitution simply cannot operate without that kind of adjustment, that kind of compromise. So you can see when you bear this in mind why it is that constitutional lawyers find it very disquieting when the American polity seems to speak most loudly in terms of anti-compromise and in terms of an uncompromisable absolutism of principle on the part of one speaker or another, or indeed on the part of one major political party and another. And the question which insists on being faced in these circumstances is this: how long can we expect the American people in their hearts to support a constitution which on a daily basis is demonstrably in a state of inconsistency with the daily practice of politics in our American life? We don't have an answer to that question, and the point is we don't want to find out. And because we don't want ever to have to find out the answer to that question, alternative avenue is to try to look at some of those influences that seem to contribute to bring about the intransigent rhetoric and the reality behind it, and to consider what can be done about mitigating the force of those influences in propelling so much of American rhetoric and practice today in the direction of anti-compromise. And that is going to be the subject of my colleagues this morning. Obviously, with only four of us and a limited amount of time, we're not going to canvass the entire landscape. You will not, for example, be hearing, I think you will not be hearing, anything about the influence of internet news sources as a source of sort of cherry-picking by those who do not want to hear any viewpoint likely to oppose their own. I personally take it that that is one of the sources that leads to or feeds an inclination to intransigence and anti-compromise. What we will try to address this morning are the following subjects, both to assess their significance in leading to a culture of intransigence, and in giving some consideration to what can be done about them, if indeed they turn out to be the culprits, which I think are generally assumed to be. First, we're going to spend a little time looking at the effects of congressional districting in creating an uncompromising politics, the kind of districting decisions that, with certainly the acquiescence of the Supreme Court, regards it as legitimate to try to protect incumbents when district lines have to be redrawn, and the kind of districting that as a consequence of that produces what we all refer to as safe seats, seats in which the competition among political positions is reduced. And Heather Gherkin is going to sort of pull the laboring oar on that to start with. We're going to pass to the question of the influence of the current limitations on regulating political campaign finance as, again, leading to a kind of extremism in positions. Jeffrey Stone is going to lead off with that, and he is also, I think, going to cover a second related issue of political practice, and that is the significance of the popular primary in, again, leading to the phenomenon that we've got this morning. Following Jeff, Mickey Edwards is going to deal, I think, primarily with the political primary issue, with some thoughts in particular from the standpoint of someone who has been in a political arena, which the rest of us have not, some thoughts about what can be done in practical terms. And I probably should add that I know from our discussions amongst ourselves that there is no, absolutely none, porous border between the subject matter that any one of these members of the panel are going to discuss and the subject matter of the others. So there's going to be a certain give and take and flow of subject matter. But those are going to be the three high points. And let's get going with Heather right now on districting.